Son of a Silverback by Russell Kane. Read by Russell Kane. Thanks to the poet Maggie Butt and novelist Sue G for taking a punt. Thanks to Mum for waving me on. Thanks to Lindsay for keeping me upright. And thanks to Dad for all the material that follows. You miserable bastard. Love. Foreword by primatologist R.D. Grineau. The Western Lowland Gorilla is the biggest of all the great apes. This meaty, knuckle-walking, bipedal primate gives the nimble chimp a run for its money as the most famous ape. If you could choose to observe only one in the wild, be honest, would you choose cheetah or King Kong? Of course, to actually see one, you must travel to Central Africa. Yes, contrary to popular belief and recent sightings, these creatures don't nest in Romford, Newcastle or Cardiff. The 200-kilogram males, in particular, are astounding creatures, moving in slow motion through the fetid swamps and forests, like a steroided man from the only way is Essex, going to the bar for a lit Zambuca. Gorillas dress to impress too, coarse, jet-black fur, and once they reach adulthood, the distinctive silverback. What is more unusual, however, is the lack of other males in the group. Most species in the primate order have multiple man-monkeys and apes in their groups. Chimps and bonobos have a chaotic mix of man-slag challengers, Garys, Terrys and Kevins, all of them fighting to be leaders for the shagging rights with the high-ranking Tinas, Donnas and Kellys, most of whom are opportunistic floozies when their chosen fella isn't keeping tabs. Not so with gorillas. No slappers. Don't get me wrong, you do occasionally find the odd gorilla troop with more than one adult male, but it's rare. You might observe a few adolescent blackback males flanking the double-hard leader for protection. But once their post-adolescent fur starts silvering, they're expected to sod off from their natal group and earn their own fucking living. The dominant male gorilla is not a bad being. He's not evil. He's not even that violent. He's just a big, scary silverback who likes to be in charge, and whatever he says goes. I'm paying, I'm saying. He decides where they live, what they eat, what they do, when they sleep, play and talk. When it comes to making up a troop, girls and adult females are usually welcome. But if you're a boy, you've got about 12 years before you need to get out of his way. And no amount of fur grooming or arse kissing will help you. You'll never be the silverback. You're on your own. Good luck, boy, said the dad. Prologue. Footnote, or as my mate Warren said as he unblocked the toilet when we were in Butlins, now that's a prologue. My dad, Dave, the steroid-using doorman, lifeguard, sheet metal worker, builder and bodybuilder from Barking in Essex, clutched his chest and dropped down dead in September 2003. For me, that was the moment I went from child to man. It shook up everything. It was the day I began my big boy life. Maybe I'd never really left my Moses basket. Certainly my old man's sudden death was my Red Sea moment. Scary, waves crashing, but somehow I just walked through. It was the crazy, miserable old bastard's final act in the making of me. That's why it belongs before my beginnings. The beginnings in a minute, keep reading. He wasn't old, my old man. It turned out the most powerful muscle in his 15-stone, steel-ripped, weightlifting body was his neck. His ability to thrust it into the ground meant he ignored the warning pains in his chest, the breathlessness, his body's hints to see a cardiologist. Those of you reading, who are also members of the Sudden Death Parent Club, will remember that plummeting feeling of finding out. It's a bonding experience when you meet someone else who's gone through it. So much so that when in 2006 I began chatting to a girl online about it, we thought it only proper to immediately start grief shagging and then get married and divorced within 6 months. It turned out trauma sex was an awful foundation for long-term love, but it goes to show the power of parental loss in bringing strangers together. The unexpected international phone call, the inside-out adrenaline drop, like stepping into a lift shaft and realising too late there's no lift in there. Just a dark, brutal descent. Boom. Right in the guts. No one would wish any sort of slow terminal illness on a loved one. In fact, most people themselves hope for a sudden, unaware journey from this world into the next. The next world for us atheists being nothingness, except for being eaten by slugs and peed on by tramps. But isn't it so much harder for those left behind to process the quick dispatch into oblivion? In my case, the fit, muscly Dave went on holiday with Julie to Cyprus, the Turkish half, mind you, the bargains you get when a country's unstable, boy, steaks the size of an arse cheek. Then one night after dinner, dropped down dead. Everything that happened after that phone call, I've spoken about before. Lots. On stage, in interviews, and really, everything from that moment is my career. It's all in stand-up sets, it's on YouTube, Netflix, iTunes, oh, and telly. God, you remember telly? And to write about what's already there would be, to me, utterly uninteresting. Even the phrase comedian's memoir feels like chewing on a whole pack of sleeping pills level of yawn. What I've never really written down is all the stuff that came before. I'm not about to tell some mouth-gaping, rags-to-riches story, oozing with facile gratefulness. I was never in rags, and I'm not really that rich. I started life in a solid working-class household. So piss off, pity party. I never went hungry. We even had a few decent holidays to Spain, and I had my own car when I was 17. So yes, okay, I'm a relatively successful stand-up now. But if the next tour bombs, I'll have to get an office job or work in a shop just like I used to. No yachts, no first-class flights. It's premium economy and a buy-to-let. That's my pension plan. So no rags, and as yet, nor ever is my guess, no Kanye level of wealth. I suppose there is still time for me to go full R. Diddy. But then I'll be old and shit, so it won't matter anyway. Most importantly, how boring would it be to simply tell my story, I mean? And how interesting to tell my sad, funny, aggressive, yet not physically violent, mental fucker dad story. So if you have to put that in rags two terms, it's my dad story. And in his mind, he did indeed start in rags, but finished with a shitload less than he wanted. Rags to Primark trousers, let's call it. I wish he'd lived a bit longer, but then I wouldn't have the courage to rip the living piss out of him on stage, or to carry it on in book form, and now audiobook form. And who knows what would have been the me now. Footnote, actually I do know. I probably would have continued to work in a solid job in marketing, but it does sound a little bit more mystical and impressive to end on some sort of self-analytical speculation, so I dropped it in there. A note on the text. I've always wanted to write a note on the text. This is the level of nerd we're talking. I have no real plan or message. I'm a massive fan of the novelist Murakami. Just tell a story and watch the characters be weird. Except this shit is true. Everything here is what happened to me and how it led to me being a jester for a living with a nice house, a gorgeous wife, and a daughter so satanically charged with energy that she cries if holy water touches her skin and sizzles. The stories that seem the most unbelievable are the most true, both in content and how they shaped me. But I've changed the names and obscured the identities of most people in this book. Except my mum and dad. They can handle it. Well, he's dead. Literally no choice. My early life had a Dickensian cast of manual labourers, imprisoned violent relatives, weed-smoking, swearing, fighting grandmas, and a bodybuilder slash model dad who was nothing like me but was the main reason I became me. If you read this book and hate it, you have only proved my father right. Life is shit. Every 14-year-old would surely love to hear the words I heard one Saturday night as my old man drunkenly drained the biryani sauce from his silver takeaway carton. Life's hard, boy. It's shit and it's hard. We die in pain and you have to work like a proper cunt in between. Right, I'm going to bed. And as he walked upstairs, he farted loudly. I should just pick up on that loud fart my father issued as he ascended the Wilton-covered stairs of my childhood home. Having spoken to people, I now realise that a temper fart is not normal fatherly behaviour. It was one of my father's most emphatic quirks. It's a fine example of how he approached life. Visceral, angry, funny, blunt, and offensive to the senses. Whenever there was a debate or an argument, he used his own anal gas as a full stop. He could be in full flow with mum, clashing over some household matter, and then he and his arse would deem the exchange finished. We need to talk, Dave. No, Julie, we're done. Then a thunderous walk-off, sometimes with a gorilla tail afterwaft, using his hand as a fan. This was my dad, furious, to the point of flatulence. I'm ready to begin, but before we emotionally disrobe and jump into the turbulent stories of father and son, let me share my current setting. It feels relevant. I'm wearing a porridge-stained mauve vest, an echo from a former Ibiza life. Lower down, I'm in yesterday's underwear with a yoghurt smudge near the fly opening, which doesn't look like yoghurt to anyone with a mucky mind. A green, toddler-snot-scarred hairband prevents the wild twigs of my hair from stabbing my eyes. Footwear? One flip-flop. Where are you, darling flip-flop left? Although four coffees deep, espressi in the plural, although using that plural rightly attracts fists, I haven't yet eaten. Instead, I've saved time by drinking butter and coconut oil with my coffees because I'm a victim of a stupid faddish diet that will be laughed at in 100 years when we're all dead from hypercholesterolemia. It's 10:14 a.m. I've written a silly foreword under a fake name about gorillas, but that'll never make the cut. Yeah, okay, I'm in a lovely chill-out room, a gorgeous room, the fantasy room of my intoxicated student brain a few years ago, book-lined with leathery Evelyn Waugh editions here and there, an Edwardian smoking table, an actual marble bust of Beethoven. Beethoven? I like Hard House and San Antonio Bay Ibiza, for fuck's sake. What a pretentious bellend I've become. An old desk, a real Persian rug, so that's all good. There's even a Freudian chaise lounge next to me. But it's what's upon that gorgeous piece of eBay-bought antique furniture that is the source of my mood and my clothing. It's a small, human female. My daughter, Minna Agnes Gain. She is like me, and therefore profoundly irritating. And with so much energy, it's like Stephen Hawking, RIP, developed her using powerful machines in a physics lab. She's singing Happy Birthday. It's not her birthday. She's eating a hard-boiled egg like an apple, spraying moist crumbs into my 1902 furniture, which she then jumps on, fossilising the yolk into the brushed blue fabric. She is naked from the waist down, and the white vest on her top half has a brown upward smear at the back, a shitty Nike tick that symbolises the speed and filth of being two. She is my child, and I am her dad, and right now, that's everything. Oh God, no, I don't mean in the wanky, I love my babies, they are my world way. Panic not, none of that crap from me. No, sod that, I'm not going to start lactating as I read my audiobook, don't panic. I mean that the relationship, that defining, chaotic mixing of two lives, dad and tot, is everything, energy-wise. At least, that's been my experience. It has been my main relationship, in my childhood, in my adulthood. Now it's her turn to be on the receiving end, and my turn not to have a clue if I'm getting it right.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.